So we have all seen these. Let's watch it. Look at mom. Look at mom. So I used to love watching these videos. In fact, I think part of me still does. I mean, it's contagious to see how happy and excited anybody gets when they've worked that hard to obtain something. But you have to ask yourself a few questions here. Why is there so much excitement? And why is there seemingly always a camera recording these moments now? I think on the surface, this is pretty straightforward. I mean, these are highly selective institutions. These students have worked very hard to get into, and this will likely change the trajectory of their life in a positive way. But how much does it actually matter where you go to college? How much does a school's ranking in prestige impact life on the other side? Not just for the likes, but for things like career income earning potential, for your network, for yourself. To get answers to these questions, we can't rely on reaction videos. We can't rely on singular narratives like what your friends say, what a neighbor says, what a counselor says, what a parent says, what I say. Narratives are nice shortcuts, but they don't tell the entire story. So we need to dig a little bit deeper here. We need to look into what the data says, because this is understandably a large decision. And I think you might be surprised to see what we find. We hate the idea of someone hijacking our free will. So we tell ourselves that we're less influenced than others. Yeah, you know, I know others might be influenced by those school rankings, but that's not really going to impact my decision. I know other people might be influenced by advertising, but I just click out of those internet ads. You know, I just already know what I want to buy, I guess. But surely someone must be influenced. Otherwise, why would these school rankings exist? Why would advertising exist? So this is known as the third person effect in psychology. It's where we believe that we're less influenced than others. It's a common fallacy. It's kind of similar to how, for example, 88% of people believe they're better at driving than the average driver. Statistically impossible. So here's my first step in this college selection journey. If you or your child are starting to sift through what college makes the most sense for me, assume your perception of college, that is, what is a good college, has likely been influenced by some external factor that's outside of your control that you're probably not fully aware of. I'm willing to make the assumption that the third person effect happens to me. There are things that influence me that I'm not fully aware of. I would just ask you to do the same, because one of these factors, as you're about to see, is quite significant in the college world, and that is the creme de la creme, the gospel of college hierarchy rankings, the U.S. News College Rankings. Imagine you're comparing two cars to purchase. One of these fine vehicles is the Chevy Spark, with the following specifications: 98 horsepower, 0 to 60 in 10.7 seconds, 118 pound-feet of torque, and 29 miles per gallon. What a ride. The second car is the Tesla Model X Plaid, which goes 0 to 60 in 2.5 seconds, has 1,020 horsepower, 310 pound-feet of torque, and has virtually unlimited MPG. Yes, you have to charge it, but no gas. You ain't need no gas in this thing. So which car will you choose? You might have noticed that we didn't include one variable in this comparison, perhaps the biggest variable that there is, and that is cost. Well, neither does U.S. News in their primary college rankings. Hey, what do you think of like the Chevy Spark for a nice starter car? Why wouldn't you just get the Tesla Model X Plaid trim? I don't have $100,000. I don't actually have any money. This is my first car. Yeah, it doesn't matter, man. Seems a little strange, because it is. Anytime you're trying to figure out whether or not you buy something, there is an opportunity cost, whether that's money or time. You look at the return of investment minus the cost to determine value. We're missing 50% of this equation right off the bat with the primary U.S. News rankings. But maybe these rankings don't account for cost because graduates from higher-ranked schools, selective Ivy League, or just private schools go on to make more money, so it's not even worth putting that in the equation. We'll come back to that. But first, let's look at some other flaws in these rankings.
We were looking to reinvent the magazine, and the college rankings became part of that.
So that's Peter Bernstein. He was one of the magazine's editors back in the 80s. But how do these rankings work?
We asked them to base it on their view. I mean, we believe that aggregate views represent where those schools stand in the marketplace. Do they necessarily know a lot about all the schools they're rating? I don't know.
Okay, so imagine some stranger stops you and asks you, hey, what's it like to work at Microsoft? And you look at them and say, I'm not sure what you mean. I've never worked at Microsoft. And they say, yeah, what's it like? Individuals are supposed to rank schools they've never even been to. And 20% of the school's ranking is based on this perceived reputation, a reputation that is quite obviously flawed. And some other fun facts on the rankings. US News gives 7 times as much weighting to faculty salary as it does to student faculty ratio. That seems a little backwards because, unless you're the professor, I guess, and you're trying to figure out what school you should work at. But for the students, that's not so helpful. You maybe don't care as much what your teachers are getting paid. You maybe do care what the class size looks like because you want a smaller class size so you can spend more time with that professor. Now, then, of course, there's the cost factor, which, again, is an afterthought. It's actually not even a thought. It's not even a factor. But here we are again. Even if these rankings are unfair, if graduates from private colleges and Ivy League colleges are going on to make more money, it doesn't really matter what we think. We can moan about these rankings being unjust, unruly. But if kids are going on to make more money, so what? Well, before we leap to that conclusion again, let's look at a comparative example to see if there might be more to this story. Last year, Duke's basketball team sent five basketball players to the NBA. There are only 60 players drafted each year, and there are thousands of college basketball players, so that is statistically insane, but is Duke really responsible for transforming these players in a way that maybe a program that's less selective wouldn't have, say, NC State just down the road, no offense to the Wolfpack? Or is it Duke maybe just getting their pick of the lot and picking very good basketball players, ones that are more likely to be able to make it in the NBA because they're the best basketball players coming out of high school? Which is it?
Right to the rim.
It is foolish to assume that Duke is the reason why these players are making it to the NBA. They're not even there for a full year. These guys are one and done. They're there for maybe 9 months. And I can assure you, I'm not a North Carolina fan. I'm not saying that Duke did not play a role here, but it's small, if not infinitesimal at best. It is quite the leap, quite the assumption to assume that one of these players could not have gone to a lesser school, like NC State, and figured it out, as many other players have demonstrated coming from smaller schools and making it to the NBA. Yet you will find a similar comparison everywhere in higher education. Private school grads, Ivy League grads make more money on the other side. Therefore, the school must be doing something different. It seems funny to think of it this way. That's like comparing me to Banchero and saying, okay, the reason why Banchero made it to the NBA is because of Duke. And the reason why I did it is because I went to a Division II. I can assure you that we're not the same guy. Dang it, why do we have to show that? Yeah, we don't need to show that. We were significantly different before we got to college. Just like the average student at an Ivy League school, a highly selective school, is likely on average significantly different from a stat standpoint than a public school student. Therefore, it's not a fair comparison. To facilitate a fair comparison, we need to apply what are called controls. And this is actually known as regression in statistics, by the way. And when we do this, the results are quite different. In fact, they might encourage an entirely different college decision. Professors Stacy Dale and Alan Kruger ran a college comparison study that controlled for a few different variables. For one study, they controlled for all the basic variables previous studies had: demographics, SAT scores, and other personal characteristics. And in this model, similar students who attended more selective schools still made more money. However, they decided to control for one more variable, something previous studies had not: the average SAT score of the schools students applied to. So to lay this out, let's say we have 100 students that are highly similar to each other. These students apply to the same colleges, have the same stats, and come from nearly identical socioeconomic backgrounds, the controls we mentioned prior. Let's say 50% of them went to Penn and 50% of them went to Penn State. According to Kruger and Dale's work, there would be no statistical difference in income between the two groups. So why is this? Well, think about the last control we applied, the average SAT score of the schools applied to, and ask yourself this question: what percent of someone's success is effort and what percent is talent? Undoubtedly, effort makes up some chunk of this equation. Those who are taking the time and energy to get high SAT scores and apply to selective schools are typically working hard to do so. This undoubtedly takes time and significant energy. Those who work harder in life are more likely to make more money. Nothing new there. When we control for this variable, it made the effects of college selectivity fall substantially, to quote, indistinguishable from zero. So once we compared students who had similar characteristics such as background stats and average SAT scores of schools applied to, there was no difference in future income according to Dale and Kruger's massive study. So what does this mean? Well, it means that Penn or any Ivy League school or highly selective school maybe doesn't have the secret sauce that we thought it did. Further studies found similar outcomes with these controls applied, with the exception being minorities and students from low-income households. Now, obviously, what schools you apply to does not determine your future success. This is just one variable in a rather large equation. However, remember what we're trying to compare here. Does the college have the ability to transform your future income earnings potential in a way another college can't? That's what we're trying to look at, and what we're finding is that might not be the case if we compare two similar students. I by no means know anything about anyone's situation, so I'm not here to tell you what your future will look like based on your stats. And understand, with a large sample size, there's outliers and exceptions all across the board. We're just trying to isolate this variable of college choice making a difference on earnings. We're not really seeing a lot though. So what these studies are highlighting is something called selection bias. The colleges are selecting the more talented individuals. Going back to the basketball example, Duke is not necessarily doing anything different to truly transform their players. Their players were already highly talented well before they arrived at Duke. And this is a good thing. This is a very good thing. It's showing us that it's not necessarily where you go to college, but how you go to college. Still, there are some significant objections to this that we need to explore further. So if you found this video helpful, make sure to hit the like button and subscribe so you can see the next two parts of this three-part series centered around choosing a college. Hope to see you soon, and again, I hope you found this helpful.